joined by Brittany Holly out of the Raleigh Center, and she is going to be talking about assistive technology and OT, specifically around AT and recreation and leisure. So go ahead, Brittany, whenever you're ready.
Hey everyone, I am gonna share my screen. Let me know if you see my PowerPoint.
Yes, we do.
Okay, so as she said, I am Brittany Holly out of the Raleigh Center. Today I'm gonna be talking about leisure and play in the field of OT and AT. So first, I know it is the end of Occupational Therapy Month, so I want to wish all of the OTs and COTAs out there a happy Occupational Therapy Month. So first, I wanted to link why play and leisure is so important in occupational therapy. So play and leisure is an occupation in the occupational therapy practice framework. And also, I found a research article that was pretty good that talked about how play and leisure can be used when trying to reach a goal. So it can be used as a means to an end. So you're using it to reach an end goal, but also it should be used also as the end goal itself, because it's so important that individuals be able to access play and leisure activities. And then lastly, all in all, it creates motivation. If you have something you enjoy and you want to be able to do it, it shows you that you can do almost anything you want if you can access the important aspects of play and leisure. So why are leisure and play and sports so important? There's many different ways. This is just a short list of why these categories are important. First, it helps developmentally. So it helps individuals develop both physical and cognitive skills that are needed in everyday tasks and occupation. And then also it is social interaction. So when you participate in leisure or play or sports or recreation, you get that social input that is very important for social skills, but also gives you friends and gives you motivation to be with others and enjoy the same type of activities. The third point is purpose and goal. It gives you a directed goal. So for instance, if you enjoy a leisure activity such as art, you have that end goal to make a pretty painting or a pretty sewing project. Or if you have a goal to play in a tournament on a soccer team, the end goal is you want to win. And even if you don't win, then you still get to interact with your team members and cheer each other on. And then the inclusion, it basically brings people together. Like I said earlier, it makes individuals more inclusive with leisure, play, and sports. Most of the time, anybody, any ability can interact with each other on the same playing field, even if an individual may have a different type of ability, you can adapt it so they are still playing and interacting in the same way. And then lastly, motivation. That's the key word when we look at leisure and play. It motivates individuals. It motivates them to learn new skills that they are struggling with because they accomplished something that is very meaningful to them. So this is just a short list of some types of play and leisure activities. There are so many more out there. I just did a very short list, but play for kids is important. It's definitely important to help them develop. And then video games is definitely a popular thing for your teens, your young adults, and some adults out there. Love to play video games and connect with others through video games. Gardening is a big one that any age group can participate in. Then art, music, and games. The games is more like board games and card games. And then sports and exercise. And like I said, there are so many more out there that you can think of that may not be listed. So I just wanted to demonstrate a few atoms for play there. This is just a small amount, and I highlighted ones that look at individuals who may have a disability and may need alternative access to play. So this slide shows a few atoms. So the top red button is a switch, and it can be used to access toys. A lot of different toys can be switch access, even if you buy it already switch access, or you can modify it and make a toy switch access too. So I don't know if all of y'all out there has ever played the pie in the face game. I know I've played it before. Essentially what you would do is you would put whipped cream on the bottom corner. You would put whipped cream on the hand, and then you would mash a button, and each time it will move back and forth between the two players. And then eventually somebody will get a pie in the face. With this one, is an adapted switch access pie in the face. So you can attach whatever switch may work for that individual. There's all different types of switches that can be used, and they can enjoy that game with their peers or their family members. The middle picture of the lion is a switch access lion that dances and makes noise when you access it with a switch. And then the airplane up top makes noise and moves when you use a switch. So I did put two different styles of switches. So the one on the bottom, right above enabling devices, that one is a pillow switch. It's a little softer than the red switch at the top, but these are just two examples of different switches that can be used. The next video is going to show just a switch being accessed with the little tiny United Airlines plane, which is a switch access. Let me know if you can hear the video.
So this is a plate switch. So essentially it is used to operate different devices for individuals who may have difficulty accessing toys or the object they are trying to operate by hand. So for instance, it teaches cause and effect, as we're gonna see when we plug it into the plane. So you would plug it into Jack here. And then when you mash the button, the plane activates. So it is a fun way to get kids engaged with their peers and in their environment, and allow them access to different toys and play. There's all different types of switch that can be used based on the individual's abilities.
Okay, and then the next category I wanted to discuss is music, art, and gardening. This is just a few atoms that are out there and available. I just did a broad overview. The first one, the skug, I'm hoping I say that right. So we have one in the center, but right now it's currently not working. So the skug is basically a music box that connects to an app on an iPad or an iOS device. So you can use it on a Mac too. So it is an Apple product ran. And you don't have to know music to be able to use it. But essentially what you would do is you would mash all the different circles on there and you would create music and play along with music. They have different games on the app that allows you to keep up with music, and it takes very minimal pressure to be able to press the circles. So it can be used with a lot of different ability styles, and it's fun. It can be used with kids or adults. The second one is, I know a lot of people like to play guitar, learn to try to play guitar. And one of the things that we notice is when individuals have maybe fine motor control or arthritis in their hands start cramping up trying to hold that guitar pick because it's very small. It's kind of awkward to hold. So this is just an adapted guitar pick. This is one out of probably a million different adaptive guitar picks out there. You can buy one commercially or you can make one yourself. Essentially what you would do with this guitar pick is you would put your finger through the hole, and it kind of holds it onto your hand, so you don't have to worry about gripping it or it falling out of your hand when you're trying to use it. And then the bottom picture with the yellow steam ripper, I don't know, but for all the sewing individuals out there, quilting individuals, this is made for an individual who may have low vision or just a little bit hard to see the small steam, I can't say that word, but steams. So you can use this and it magnifies what you're trying to take out. I know I'm a sewer and I mess up a lot. So I use one of these quite a bit, and it's helpful to be able to see the actual seam you want to be able to take out of the quilt or the object you're sewing. And then the next two items is for gardening. The first one in the middle is the bench. It can be used as a bench to have you at like eye level, at chest level with the plant you're working with, so you don't have to stand over and try to trim it or work with the plant. Or you can flip it over and use it as a kneeler. So you can put your knees on it. I know like sitting on the ground on your knees end up making your knees hurt and ache. So this just gives it a little cushion, but also has the supports to be able to help you once you're done picking weeds or doing whatever you're doing in the garden. The last one is a weed picker. So it's a stand-up weed picker. So I know I hate gardening and having to go pick weeds. So this makes it a little easier. You can stand up, don't have to bend over, and you can pull the weeds out. And I do have two videos coming up showing those two devices.
This is a garden bench that can be used as a bench or a kneeling position. So as we are going to demonstrate, she is going to sit down. If she were trimming the bush here, she would be able to sit on the bench and be at eye level. But if she needed to get down and say plant a flower or pull weeds, she could flip it over and use it as a knee support, but also a support to be able to stand up once she needs to be able to stand up. This is a stand-up weed puller. So what you're going to do is you go to your garden bed where you want to weed. You would stick it in the weed you want to pull up. You would step on the little wedge like she just did, press down, turn the equipment, pull up, and then you mash the button on top to empty the weed.
And I am sorry, I did not discuss the last one, which is the paintbrush on the top of the, right beside the guitar pick. So, that's basically a foam roll that increases the grip of the paintbrush, but there are so many different types out there. So I have a few, if you look at the video of me, in the corner. So this one is an egg shape. It can be used for any type of writing utensils or virtually any material that you're trying to hold and use. So you can, I just have a bigger paintbrush and you squeeze it and just insert it. And it helps individuals be able to grip a bigger surface that is not as slick because it is very like rubbery feeling. And then we also have weighted, this is a universal weighted cuff for a pen, but you can use it essentially for any type of writing or crayon or paintbrush to be able to draw a picture, paint a picture. And it's just weighted. There's different weights that are available. This would be your typical black foam roll. There's all different ones, all different shapes and sizes, and you can just cut it to fit whatever you are working with. And then I did want to show adaptive scissors, which you see a lot for individuals who may have any type of disability, fine motor control. So this is an adaptive pair of scissors that an individual may use. And also, this is another pair of adaptive scissors that makes it easier for an individual to use.
This,
So my next slide just talks about games and video games. I know a lot of people out there love to sit around and have a family night where it's all games, and then you may have different abilities in the group, and you want to be able to cater to everyone in the group. So here's just a overview, because there's so many more, of what games may be available. So there is Uno, and this Uno is special because it does have Braille, so individuals who are blind can use this Uno and be able to play with their family members. The bottom is, I used to use this a lot in grad school with my kiddos in the school. This is a good behavior game. It basically teaches like self-regulation and behaviors and norms of how you interact, but in a fun way. And then the top one is just an adaptive like video control system. So individuals who may have different abilities can interact with video games in a different way. The Monopoly here, this is just one of so many different ones. This one is unique because it is switch access. So it allows the individual to be able to move their player with a switch versus having to physically pick up the objects and move, which is pretty cool. And then the last one is a card holder, and I have one to show. So essentially what you would do is, if you had trouble holding it or had arthritis and needed to be able to display your cards in an easier way, you would simply, when you got a card, you would just stick it in and it holds it. You can flip it over and it's not going to fall out. And it allows you to be able to just view all of your cards at once. But there's all different options. So here's another option of a card holder. So as you see, it's just a wooden block that sits on the table, and you would just slide your card in and out of it to be able to display it that way too. This slide is sports and exercise. So this is just a small list of what is out there. But the top one is an action track chair. It's an all-terrain chair that individuals could use hunting and fishing, or if you want to go on a hike. I know there's a state park, not in North Carolina, but another state that offers these to individuals to be able to utilize when they go on hikes with their peers. There's all different types of all-terrain wheelchairs out there. That's just one that I just demoed. And then the middle one is for fishing. So to reel in a fish, some individuals may have difficulty actually holding that little tiny reel and trying to reel in. So this cuff connects this to the reel itself, and individuals can reel with more gross motor movements versus fine motor movements. The soccer ball over here is unique because it is for individuals who are blind or low vision who want to play soccer. They have volleyballs too. We have a deflated one because we don't have a pump to blow it up yet, but you can hear it. So it allows the individual who is blind or low vision to hear where the ball is going, so they can find it on whatever course they're accessing, so a soccer or a volleyball court. And then the bottom picture is a hand cycle. This one is mainly used for like street cycling or mountain cycling, but it just even out the playing field for an individual who may can't use their legs to cycle. They can use their hands. The middle picture is an adaptive kayak. These are outriggers that are placed on the kayak for an individual who may don't know their sense of balance in their middle. So this allows them to be able to access the water like everyone else without the fear of flipping over. I know anyone can use that, even small kids. And then the last one is just a sled. So I know we live in North Carolina, so we have the hurricanes. So I wanted to show that individuals with any form of disability can also be a hockey player and use a sled. There's all different adaptations for a sled for individuals who may need to be pushed versus using their own momentum to play the sport. I like to post a list of just resources and sports to sports that are available. So the top list is just a brief one for North Carolina. So there's Bridge to Sports, Catalyst Sports, Access to Wilmington, and ASAP, which is in Charlotte. And then the last list is a brief for the U.S. So Move United is an adaptive exercise program. They have it where anyone can exercise whatever ability you may have. And then the second one is Challenge Athletes Foundation. They have camps and events, but they also have grants to help individuals fund sporting equipment or sporting costs to events. And then the last one is Team USA. So if you had a desire or want to play a sport, say you're like, hey, I want to try rowing or para rowing, you can go to Team USA and look at what state you're in and what location you're in and see what rowing team may be available for you to go try out the sport. And I like to end with the main importance I want to drive is play, leisure, and sports equals inclusion. It equals that everyone can be on the same playing field, can have access to the things that make them feel like they're hitting a goal, that motivates them, that gives them happiness and a sense of purpose. And then I also do have the references. So if you did want to look up the OT framework or the research article I quoted earlier, they're on this too. Does anybody have any questions?
Brittany, there is one question. Are there any tools for embroidery for individuals with right hemiparesis?
Yes, there are a lot of tools out there for individuals who want to embroider. There are one-handed. If you use a machine, they have adaptive machines, but if you do it by hand, there are different tools out there that you can do it one-handed. I actually was going to post a picture of one, and I was like, I don't know how many people so I wasn't sure.
All right. Thanks, Brittany. I hope that was hope that answered your question. All right. With that, I don't see any other questions. I hope everybody has a great weekend, and I hope you guys all stay safe.